Thank you very much. So today's talk is again something about the virtual fundamental chain. What I remember is that 2 years ago I gave a talk in the same room, and that is something also construction of a virtual fundamental chain. But that part is kind of based mostly on analysis. And today I want to focus more on topological type things, assuming all analysis. So something what virtual fundamental chain should do is the following things. You start from some moduli spaces of some pseudo-holomorphic curve. There are many kinds of moduli spaces of pseudo-holomorphic curve, but the argument I suppose to apply in all cases, but just to specify later on, but I just want to consider some moduli spaces. And the first thing to do is that you write down some equations, some boundary conditions, some data, and prove it is compact, or something like that. That's the first step. Then the next step people do this is to say, in our particular formulations, we want to prove that M has some structure, which I call Kuranishi structure. I'll explain a bit more later, but anyway. That is the first step. And then the next step is kind of defined. This fundamental class of M. Or maybe in a case M has a boundary, it's so-called fundamental chain in some chain model. So this is actually a two-step process. And something which is a bit not I'm not so much happy is that this is not short. I believe it is impossible to write in 30 pages. Maybe 300 is a borderline. So in that case, it is better somehow to write down some statement which you can quote, and many people do not need to read it. What I remember is that when Dominic Joyce gave some talk in Simon Center, he says that I need to write it only once, and you don't need to read it. So it's a kind of statement. So one need to write a clear statement so that you can just use as a rhythm. Then if somebody agrees, then you don't need to read it. That's some good thing, because people do not have so many lifetimes, so you want to save your reading. So, but then as far as this concerns, we believe that this part is kind of more packaged. More packaged means that we have some definition of Kuranishi structures, what it is, and then there is some written statement, so that if you have a Kuranishi structure, you have some virtual fundamental chain, and if this Kuranishi structure has some properties, then this virtual fundamental chain has a similar corresponding properties, blah, blah, blah. There are some things still missing, but you can just continue writing, and you can have some reasonable amount of collection of statements. Then this is what I mean by packaged. So you just need to have some well-defined rigorous mathematical definitions and some mathematical theorems, and you can use as is to obtain something you want. And compared to that part, I'm afraid to say this is not yet so much completely packaged. And the result of this is somehow sometimes when we wrote the papers, we just claim that this moduli space has a Kuranishi structures. And then the proof is similar to blah, blah, blah. So actually, it is similar. It means that if you understand the proof, then you say that this is OK.
Well, yes, of course, the problem there sometimes is that if somebody else uses it and says, well, it's similar, like where they claim it's similar, like there, therefore, by transitivity, it's similar to the other, and then it maybe doesn't work.
You know? That's right, yeah. So you say it's similar, then for the person who understands it, for a person who understands it, it takes 1 minute. And especially for the authors, okay, it is okay. But it is not always the case, as Helmut said. Of course, something is similar, but something is not similar. So you need something. So to say that, in place of saying this is similar, you want to say that using the theorem blah, 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 this has a Kuranishi structure. That's much better. Because in that case, if the theorem is wrong, then the author takes responsibility. And it's similar, nobody takes responsibility. So something I want to do is just to write some theorems so that you can use for this purpose. I think the polyfold and that kind of thing also has similar similar purposes. So, but then actually the main part of my most important thing in my talk is the definitions or statement, because one statement is written, the proof is actually already what we have written. It should be, because we kind of, in case we wrote this proof, and they want to cook up some statement so that this the proof we wrote can be used for the proof of that particular theorems. So that's the goal of this talk. So I want to write down some. So the main difficult thing is the conditions or some data. And what's bad thing is that the structure you got here is not completely canonical. So you need to put some extra data to put these things. I mean, that's a bit worse than algebraic geometry. If you know algebraic geometry, you know a lot of moduli spaces, like a moduli space of vector bounds, a moduli space of complex algebraic cycles, blah, blah, blah. And they are usually characterized by some universality property. And what good about universality property is, if it exists, then it should be unique. So you don't really need to kind of spell out the precise conditions, because you characterize the structures by universality. And the only thing you need to rigorously claim is existence. And I think the Grothendieck proved this kind of existence in great generality, so now it's safe situation. So we want to, but then in symplectic geometry or holomorphic curve business, I think this structure, at least in our formulation, is not completely canonical. So it should depend on some data. So you want to kind of spell out which data we start with kind of precisely, and what conditions those data should satisfy, and how the resulting structure depends on the data you start with. And that is the kind of things I want to explain. So before going further, I just want to explain quite a bit what we have to do. So let me take, for the sake of preciseness, I want to take this particular choices of the moduli space of pseudo-holomorphic curve, which should be applied in complete generality, but I just want to consider this case. Then this means that beta, so you have X symplectic manifold, and J is almost complex structure, compatible. And L is a Lagrangian submanifold. And beta in H2 over Z. And yes, L is safety, I want L is compact, and X should be just convex. Yeah, there should be some generalization to the case L is non-compact, but I don't want to talk now. So now this case, and K is just a number. Then this is a kind of moduli space of something like this. And so maybe first I want to just maybe sigma is a so-called border state curve. It's something like several disks with some possible sphere bubble. And then U is a holomorphic map. And the homology class of genus 0, one boundary component. And U is a holomorphic map. And its homology class is beta. And the claim we made is that this has a Kuranishi structures. And I just want to say that this particular case, the statement is very defined, it's proved. But something I want to specify is which kind of data we need to fix to get this. And there are kind of possibly many choice of data. But kind of I want to make some general assumptions so that under which assumptions this construction works. It is more general than just the case we did. So the data is basically the following things. Suppose you have some particular point. So it consists of this sigma, boundary sigma. No, the sigma ZU. I'm sorry. So Z is a K plus 1 point. K plus 1 point on this on a boundary which respects this conditions, this ordering, and it is non-singular. Then first thing I want to know is that kind of, so maybe I want to say what is Kuranishi chart. And Kuranishi chart is something like U, B, U, E, S, C, and U is an OB fold, and E is a vector bundle, and S is a section, and C is a homomorphism, M to MK plus 1, beta, and this is homomorphism to neighborhood of P. So you represent.
M is the moduli is already compact, right?
Yes, it's always compact. Okay. Compact is proved at stage 1. So we represent the neighborhood of P by the zero set of S using C, and you have an OB fold U. So this is a kind of Kuranishi neighborhood. And the construction of the Kuranishi, so main part of the construction is what is this U of P. So let me write this. This is put P. So this is the Kuranishi neighborhood of P. So let me write it U of P. And the main part of the construction is what is U of P. And U of P, this is OB4, is the set of the set of isomorphism of all sigma prime z prime u prime such that d bar u prime is equal to e u prime ep. This is the equations, and ep u prime is a subspace of the C infinity sections on this U prime star TX tensor 0-1 form. So this is a finite dimensional spaces. So you replace holomorphic curve equation by this, by adding this UP U prime. Then so you can just imagine that what you need to define is the following things. For each P plus this X is sigma plus Z plus U prime. This is similar, but U prime may not be holomorphic. So except U prime may not be holomorphic, this is similar. X close to P. Then we define some E of P of X, which is this one. So as I say that we need to fix some extra data other than the moduli space itself, right? So then this data which I want to fix is exactly this family of EPX. It means that for any point board P on the moduli spaces and any XX which is close to P, then you fix this finite dimensional subspace of smooth sections on this U prime star TX cross 0-1 form. That is the data. But of course, you need to assume that data has some property. And I want to explain in this talk which kind of data we need to assume for this EP of X so that we can cook up these constructions. And how the structure depends on this data, etc. So let me write it here. Before making more precise, I just want to mention the following things. So the data we start with, so let me call it obstruction data. Obstruction data which I want to specify is the following. For any P on the moduli space, and for any X, close to P, then we give E P X. It is a finite dimensional subspace And there are several conditions, but as I will say, the main condition I want to say is something like a semi-continuous and exponential decay plus maybe transversal. I'll explain what it is. Then we can associate as a Kuranishi structure, and its germ depends only on this data. So this is the theorem I want to state and explain. So it means that if you have some, so if you just kind of describe some particular way to the pair of P and X, some particular way of fixing finite dimensional subspaces, and there are two or three conditions as I will explain, then you can automatically obtain the Kuranishi structure on these moduli spaces. And this Kuranishi structure is well defined in a sense by up to the process that replacing this neighborhood to some smaller open neighborhood. So this process is actually very much a kind of harmless process. Maybe you have sometimes the germ of Kuranishi chart is dangerous. That's true. That's not a good notion. But germ's Kuranishi structure is okay. Everything is just including coordinate change. It is just restrictions. So in this way, so you know what's good in this way is that you want to cook up some particular Kuranishi structures on some similar moduli spaces. What you all you need to do is just to describe the way to define these spaces, and then you check these properties I just explained. I will explain. Then you don't need to. Then this is just a black box. You get this Kuranishi structure. They have another black box to go from here to bachelor fundamental classes. So in that sense, so actually this part is in a sense very much analysis. And if you, it's kind of, there is a video of the talk I gave in this room 2 years ago, and that is somehow explained this part of the analysis. And also I wrote some, with Ota Ono, we wrote some papers, exponential decay, blah, 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 blah. That's take care of this analysis. But this is a kind of black box. So if this black box is kind of worked out, then you can just forget it. And if you want to do something, then you just try to cook up this structure. And actually, several of our papers actually written in that way, even though we don't write this part. Because we just in many papers, we just wrote, OK, how to define this substantial spaces. Then say that, OK, in a similar way as blah, 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 we can obtain a Kuranishi structure. And in the similar way, we replace this block box. That's my purpose. And I want to, before going further, I want to explain some advantage to do this. So there is something one can try to prove, some applications of this kind of construction.
Is there also a theorem that says that if you now vary these choices of obstruction bundles nearby, that the Kuranishi structure is related by some?
So what we can prove, okay, so let me state two claims about it.
Parametric
version of
this.
Parametric version. I think that's included in this statement, because if you just consider moduli space cross 0, 1,
okay,
then this parametric version has this property.
Okay.
So you have the parameterized version of this particular theorem, so you have this same thing. But another thing about where it defined is the following thing. So kind of there are some propositions. You have two choices, so that E1P X is contained E2P X. Then you have these two Kuranishi structures. You have this Kuranishi structure 1, Kuranishi structure 2 of these moduli spaces. And I'm sorry that I don't want to define its notion, but there is something called embedding of Kuranishi structure from one to the other. Okay, you have two structures are embedded to each other. And the corollary is that they are covariant. Actually, this is very easy to prove once everything is done. And once it's embedding, there's a copolarism, it's also easy to prove. And the other statement is the following. So you have these two EPI. EP and EP prime is equivalent if and only if you have this kind of things, EP1, EP2, blah, 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 kind of zigzag. So this is an equivalence relation. You have included to one to the other, then you say it's equivalent, and you have an equivalence relation related to this. Then this proposition is that all two are equivalent. Equivalent by this equivalence relations. So the corollary is that all the structures which satisfy this, which came out from this particular constructions, are coordinate to each other.
So in principle, could you just make a universal choice by choosing all structures? You
know, that's possible. Yeah. I mean, you know, in place of, you know, kind of just change the formulations. Here you have a kind of, for each p, you have this just one family. Mm-hmm. But you can include the case you have a p for many families. They have kind of all structures and they have just one. Probably, yeah. So this is a statement, and so something I want to explain is so first of all it's a bit imprecise is.
So if the domain is fixed and it chooses EPs, you could actually choose two finite dimensional bundles which are not contained in a finite in a bigger finite dimensional bundle.
Yeah.
It's possible.
Yeah, but this is why we need this zigzag. You have some finite dimensional subspaces. And you have some a bit go and go down, and you continue finitely many times, you can just go everywhere. You just start from this and this, the sum may be not finite dimensional. For example, you have something something. Then you have just something like near the border of the support. You have some compact set, which is disjoint from the support over here. Then you can just add this part. Then this part only is strong enough to cook up transversality. Then you have the smaller support, then you have another thing. So you can just go from one to the other at finitely many stage. And we have just two finite dimensional spaces. Then you just sum it, as I heard, this can be infinite dimensional. But you have a kind of go and back by zigzag. I think you have two Banach spaces, finite dimensional subspaces. You have a row to this zigzag. Certainly you can go from one to the other. Because you have some 100 dimensions, you have some stuff completely away from that, then you can just go back. So this zigzag makes it possible. So this is the definition. This is the claim. So this is the definition of equivalence.
Yes.
Equivalence, and the claim is everything is equivalent. EP and EP prime are both obstruction data. It means that this family of finite dimensional subspaces, which satisfy these three conditions, which I didn't explain yet. Mm-hmm. Then you have this zigzag, so that these two
behave. So all two are equivalent.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
So all two are equivalent, then all two are coordinate, by corollary. Yeah. Yeah. So embedding of Kuranishi structure means that you take open substructure and then embed. So it's a kind of definition. Only germ is very defined, so you have to take the process open substrate. Okay. So now I want to mention some kind of applications where I can use this kind of ideas. It's the following. So suppose we have the following situations. Yeah, actually, there is one theorem that I need to say that there exists such a EP. Otherwise, everything is trivial. But that's actually a bit non-trivial, but there exists such a system. Okay, but let me consider the following situation. Suppose you have G. This G is a compact group. And this action is preserved symplectic form. Then we have this J is preserved. Then suppose L is the equivariant. Then I say this system of this finite dimensional subspace is equivariant. So definition is E X A E P X is G equivariant. This is very easy. E, Zp, Zx is G star, Ep, X. So what I mean by this? So P or X, P is something you can see that sigma Zu. Then Z of P you don't change sigma, you don't change z, but you can just move this by g actions. So you can easily see that if p is x is close to p, then gx is close to gp. G is just isometry. Then we have this g star. Maybe which way? Yeah, it's a differential form, so it might be better something like this. So g star is a c infinity sections of c prime of this u gu prime star tx 0, 1. And this is naturally pullback. You can imagine that there is a kind of canonical map like this. And this definition is that using this things, you have this, everything is equivariant. And the claim is following. If this EP X is G equivariant, then the corresponding Kuranishi structure can be made is G equivariant. This means that locally you have this U E S C, and you can just say that G acts all of this U E S. G acts on U and E, and S and C are G equivariant. So that is a theorem. So if you cook up some way to have this finite dimensional obstruction bundle, so that this construction is a G equivariant, then you can cook up your Kuranishi structure so that it is a G equivariant also. So this is somehow just a kind of coming from this usual construction, but it's a bit, I mean, you know, U is G equivariant means that somehow, so this is P. So UP contains, image of phi P contains G neighborhood of P, right? Because this image should contain P, but this is G equivariant. So this is a bit bigger. This should contain G equivariant. So for this, you need some process. First you cook up this guy, then you need to glue them over G orbit. But once we have this construction, it's something like everything is G equivariant and canonical, we can do it. But actually, something which is not trivial is to find such a system of EPX. And if you look this paper which we published in Asterisk, in this mirror symmetry and Lagrangian flare theory on toric manifold, then we found this kind of structures in a case of toric manifold, and it's a bit rather complicated process to obtain this kind of system which satisfies equivalence, you can imagine. And we can prove that existence in complete generality, but it involves more. So we need to try to do some separate paper to prove the existence of this kind of equivariant data. And what's good in our black box is once we get this equivariant data, then the equivariant Kuranishi structure is automatically obtained.
So can I ask what generality means? Generality means like
compact group.
Components of the identity is Hamiltonian, in Hamiltonian way?
I don't need Hamiltonian condition. Just compact group of symplectic homomorphism. And J is G invariant. Yeah, I mean, you can imagine that this is not very easy. There are a lot of things one has to think, but there are it with us. Okay, so this is one way. This is one kind of things. And the other kind of thing is, I think in abstract I wrote is about a forgetful map. So basically, what is good of this kind of thing is, kind of the construction is, we try to make it closer to canonical, not completely canonical. So what's good to be canonical is that you can keep more symmetry. It means that the construction of virtual fundamental chain, sometimes you want to cook up resulting chain has some property, especially for some symmetry. For example, you have some equality, which you have a moduli spaces, then if you just think it very naively, the moduli space has some equality, then you want to realize this equality in the virtual fundamental chain. And perturbation is a process which sometimes breaks symmetry, because symmetry and transversality is contradictory. But so at least I want to kind of carry out all the symmetry you can which is visible in a moduli space to the level of the Kuranishi structure. And since this construction, as I explained, is somewhat canonical, so it is better to keep this symmetry. And one symmetry, so one symmetry is this obvious symmetry of target space group actions. Now the other symmetry, there are another symmetry, but the other symmetry I can clearly say is this forgetful map. So let me mention this way. So let me consider this forgetful map, which is m, for example, mk plus 1 beta to mk beta. So this is something like this. They have this sigma. So you have this sigma g0 gk u, and then you can just forget k, but I don't need to write g prime u. So this means that first you forget this case marked point, but then there is something called a stability, stable map, and the stability may be broken. So you shrink some component of the source curve so that you get a stable map. So example is the following. Suppose you have your sigma and here, and you have this, for example, you have this marked point. But then here u is not constant. And here u is not constant. And suppose that u is constant here. Then suppose that this is z0 and this is z1. It's counterclockwise, this is z2. So this configuration is stable because you have this marked point. This trivial disk has three marked points, so it is stable. So this is contained in a moduli space. But then if you remove this, so if you remove this second marked point, then you get this configurations. Just this. And this is u is constant here. And this is not a stable map. So you have to shrink this component. Then this is the sigma bar. And this is non-constant. So this is stable constant. So this is this map on the moduli space. So now the claim is the following things. So if you suppose that you have this guy, then suppose that this E P X is this kind of obstruction bundle data. Obstruction data. Yeah, obstruction data on below. Any obstruction data below. Then we can pull back. To this mk plus 1 beta. So how you put it back? You have this p on this mk plus 1 beta. Then if you forget p, let me write it q, then this is the element of this ep. No, this is the element of mk beta. Moreover, if x is close to p, maybe I need to say that the notion x is close to p is something we have to define. And to define the notion that x is close to p, we need to fix some data which is kind of stabilization of p. But something we can prove is that the notion being close is independent on the choice of the stabilizations. So that's a kind of lemma. So maybe I want to write it here. So p plus something called the stabilizations, called st, then we can say
which category do we work? So is everything continuous or smooth?
Everything is so far smooth because you can just, I don't know, maybe u prime can be L2K. K is sufficiently big.
So if I had, so for example, when you glue stuff and you want to have a Fredholm theory, then you have to choose sort of gluing profile or something. Then this forgetful map there is actually
the forgetful map we define only on the moduli spaces.
Right, but so say the modular space you get have smooth structures on them, yeah? That is
yes.
So when you forget sort of in the Lin-Mumford, if you have this forgetful map, you throw away a marked point in the
yes.
string. Then if the gluing profile is sort of this logarithmic gluing profile, that's actually a holomorphic procedure. But if you want to do the Fredholm theory, then with Kosher-Riemann, you have to choose that differently because otherwise it doesn't work.
No, that I know, but something, you know, we are just saying about obstruction boundary data. Obstruction boundary data just associates
it's
to this.
Bad, I believe, but it's not, but forgetting marked points is not smooth, I think.
Yes?
That's not smooth.
Yeah. So I don't say the Kuranishi map between Kuranishi neighborhood is smooth.
Okay, good. Just want to point that out.
Yeah, yeah.
One has to know that.
Yeah, but there's a way to handle it.
No, sure.
Yeah.
But
it's non-trivial, yes, yes.
Yeah.
So, okay, so P plus stabilization says that X, the notion X is epsilon close to P. Stabilization, I don't know. I'm sorry to say I didn't define it yet. But the stabilization data is a choice of finitely many marked points, extra marked point, so that source curve became stable.
A source curve will be stable.
Stable. And you fix some finitely many. So let me say it. Stabilization data, you have this kind of sigma zu, right? Stabilization data is maybe w, which is something like a sigma z plus w is stable. And for each wi, you fix, so you have this kind of sigma, u of sigma, and this is u of wi. You fix some called a ki, ni, some codimension to some manifold, which is transversal to here. This means that here u prime is nearby, then you have automatically corresponding points. And once we fix this w and this ni, then you can define the notion that x is epsilon close to this guy with respect to this stabilization data. The definition is maybe since we have started. So so this guy is something like a sigma prime u prime z prime, right? Then u prime is close to u. Then you have this kind of wi prime corresponding to this wi using this ni. Then this guy is close to this guy. I mean, once this source is stable, it is easy to define that this is close to this. So we fix this stabilization data. You can say that unknown map is close to the original map. In a sense, in the C0 topology. This is one can define. And the non-trivial claim is that if you change the stabilization data, the closeness is the same. So the lemma, for each epsilon, there exists delta. If x is delta close to p with respect to one stabilization data, for each st1, st2, then x is epsilon close to p stabilization 2. No. X is just something, some LK1 map. Maybe you assume that it is holomorphic near the neighborhood of the neck, for example, to make things easier. I mean, the condition is that in the neighborhood of the X, the image epsilon diameter is close, and the outside of the neck it is C0 close up to epsilon. That's the definition. And also the source curve in the Lin-Mumford is close. So if you do that definition, then the lemma is that this closeness is well defined in this sense. It's a bit delicate because this is not a topology. Because you can define the notion as x is close to p, but I don't want to define the notion p is close to x. You only want to define the neighborhood of the moduli spaces. Because if x is not holomorphic, then you may have a trouble. So, but what is certainly true is that we can just define this. And this is actually, you just try to prove it is not difficult to prove. It's something like how to use stability. But because of these definitions, then you just be a bit careful about epsilon delta. You can say that for sufficiently close element, you define this obstruction bundle data. It means that for each stabilization data, you have some epsilon, so that x is epsilon closed with respect to this stabilization data, you have a obstruction bundle. So that's some epsilon delta you have to do.
But say the choice of your obstruction bundle, usually I guess you expect that the support is away from the nodes. And
that's right. That's a part of the conditions for E. So this is a kind of things. So I just want to say that. So I just want to go finish this forgettable bundle data. So now once we know this, then you can just prove the following things. The similar x epsilon data. So if x is epsilon delta close to p, then forget x is epsilon close to forget p. So you see a moduli space of forgettable map, and you have something above the forgettable map. Then you do the same forgetting. Then if this is close to p, then this is close to p. So it means that so in our situations, this guy, for this guy, you get obstruction bundles. Then this guy and this guy actually had the same source curve, in a sense, canonically identified. So you can pull back obstruction bundle data here. So you know this is easier to do in a level of obstruction bundle data than the level of moduli spaces, because this is just a kind of finite dimensional spaces. Yes.
So, but after you forget.
Yeah, after you forget, then the condition means that this part is very almost constant.
Okay.
But then you pull back the obstruction bundles, then you don't have any obstruction bundle on this component, which is close to constant. But you don't need it, just because constant map is transversal. So that's the way things works. So this is an idea. Then we need to check that these two conditions are preserved. But once we understand the condition, it is rather easy to check it. So what is good is once you have this obstruction bundle data downstairs, you can pull back. So now from this you use our result so that you have a Kuranishi structure both above and below. Then above and below you have some natural relation between Kuranishi chart, and you can see this one. Then what we can do is that you can make some particular form of perturbation downstairs so that you can always pull back this kind of perturbations. I mean, if your perturbation is exponentially small, then you can pull back, still smooth. So that's the way to handle this point. I mean, one easier thing is just to define obstruction bundle, forgettable map is extended to Kuranishi neighborhood. It's a bit problematic. Because Kuranishi neighborhood is obifold, and the morphism obifold, I don't want to use so much. It's a bit complicated things. But to pull back obstruction bundle data is a more set theoretical thing, so you can safely do so. Okay, so now this is how to apply this, the kind of things. And there are several other things we can try to apply. For example, if you want to have some consistency at the boundary, I mean, if you have a moduli space in the boundary, the fiber product of something, you can write down the same conditions for this data, and if you check it, then this condition for the Kuranishi structure is automatic. So that's another thing. But anyway, so now, so in the rest of my talk, I want to formulate these two conditions. So first is this semi-continuity. So this is the first condition. So what it is? So it is the following. So suppose P is an element of a moduli space. Then one can prove the following thing. So suppose Q happen to be the element of a moduli space is epsilon close to P. I'm sorry, I just want to do not want to fix stabilization data in each step because it's a bit annoying. So but suppose that this. Then we can say that if x, this is not necessary in a moduli space. Suppose that is delta close to q, then x is probably epsilon plus o delta close to P. This means that, so you have P here, and you have a Q here, and you have X is close to here, then this is still not so far away from P here. I mean, this is a bit kind of, you need to be careful to make these notions, because this close is again, as I said, this is not a topology. It's not symmetric. But still, this kind of thing is correct. It's something similar to this triangle inequality. And this is actually, once you define it, so it's kind of obvious. So what it means? So then what I can say about this semi-continuity? So semi-continuity is the following. So this data is semi-continuous. Yeah, I'm sorry, it's opposite. It's semi-continuous if for each p there exists epsilon such that, sorry, this is suppose that q is epsilon close to p, then E Q X is contained in E P X for X sufficiently close to Q. So what it means that if Q is sufficiently close to X, then automatically Q X is sufficiently close to P by what I said before. So these two actually something like a C infinity space of sigma prime U prime star T X cross 0, 1. Here this X is the sigma prime, Z prime and U prime. Right? Because this is by definition, this is the finite dimensional subspace of this. This is by finite dimensional subspace of this. So you have these two vector spaces, and semi-continuity means that this guy is contained here in a set theoretical sense. So it means that if you start from P, you have this finite dimensional vector spaces, and you go nearby, it makes smaller, but not that bigger. So it's always contained. So this is something like a semi-continuity. And this is the one conditions we require. And what good is from this, you can automatically see that UQ is somehow contained in UP. Why? So UQ is a set of equations d by u of this EU prime is this EQ u prime, right? And this one is contained in this EP u prime, and this second equation is defining an equation here. So you satisfy these equations, so this set theoretical relations. And this is actually, if you know the definition of Kuranishi chart, called the change of Kuranishi chart, implies that you have a change of coordinate in Kuranishi chart. So once you fix this semi-continuity conditions of this obstruction boundary data, then existence of Kuranishi chart is actually rather obvious. And furthermore, co-cycle condition of this chart coordinate change is actually obvious because it's just an inclusion map. So you have just two inclusion maps. So it's just co-cycle condition. OK, so now this is semi-continuity. And as I said, that this is related to the existence of this coordinate change. And something more delicate is the next conditions. What is that is about exponential decay that I want to explain and I want to finish. And this exponential decay condition is something related to the analysis. So analysis means that once you have this EP, then you consider the solution set of this equations, and you want to prove that the set of solutions is something like orbifold. It means that it's considered some smooth manifold. And for this, you need several conditions. One is something I call transversality, but that's a kind of, this is enough big to make it transversal. And the other condition is more serious. One easy condition is that this space should depend in a smooth way to U prime. So if you move U prime in a sobered spaces in a smooth way, then this vector space is smooth. And that's not so difficult conditions to state. But something more delicate is the following point. Our stable map contains singularity. So in a neighborhood of singularity, you have various parameters. And there are some parameters which controls the way you resolve the singularity. And how this obstruction bundle behave with respect to that parameter is actually the most difficult part to handle. And this exponential decay conditions says that this obstruction bundle, in a sense, behave in exponential order nicely with respect to this conditions that I want to describe. And once we know that this exponential decay conditions, then in a sense, this analysis is written so that the set of solutions satisfy required property if this condition is satisfied. Okay, so now what I want to say the following things. So let me consider the simplest case that P is like this. And this is P. Then there are several parameters. Yeah. So what is unknown thing X? It's something like this. But I want to write it something like this. So there are several parameters, but one important parameter is this t. So this is the t is infinity zero, but this is t infinity, but this is t. So one Green parameter, and then you have this u1 prime, u2 prime. So first of all, I want to assume E, x, so x is this moduli space plus u1 prime, u2 prime, u prime. So Ex depends only on u1 prime, u2 prime. That means that this part is independent. So this is independent. So this so E of x independent on this part. You have this very long neck, and your moduli your finite dimensional spaces depend only on this thick part, the map, thick part of the map.
But that means that there's some supported there.
Supported there.
Support is away from the nodes.
No. There are two things. Element here is supported here,
okay.
But also.
I mean, also this inclusion presumably already used there.
I mean, so this one is so also. There are two things I want to say. The element is supported,
yeah.
But also there are another thing. Here, it means that if you change the map here a bit here, but your vector space does not change, so it is depend only how this u1 prime u2 prime behave on this thick part. How it depends on the sim part is independent. But as a part of the condition that this is epsilon closed, this sim part should, diameter of this sim part should be epsilon after you map to this. So now, I think this is just a 3 points. So there is no moduli parameter on this part. So your element, your map is something like this, right? Ah, yeah. So your map is, yeah, so. U1 prime, ui prime is some map like this, right? To x, l. And this source is actually independent on t. I want to emphasize. So if you remove this part, then this. Yeah. This part of the domain, you have a natural identification to this kind of domains. So this domain is independent, isomorphic to this. But I want to say that there are many different ways of making this isomorphic. But one thing I need to prove is that this exponential decay condition is independent of the choice of this diffeomorphism, as far as this diffeomorphism take in some particular choice we made. But anyway, so now ui dash is here. So let me write this as ki. So this I is L2k, ki prime x. So you have this some L2k spaces on this ki space to x. What is important is this space is actually independent on t or everything. You have this kind of fixed function spaces. Then the map E is a subspace. E is a subspace of this infinity. Yeah, infinity is okay. Yeah. Let me see this infinity. Yeah, I think so. Let me check. This is L2K probably. this one. And then you can just, this is your prime. You can use parallel transport in the same way. So there are some way, because UI prime and U is close there. So here you just parallel transport to identify this. This identification is fixed. So what is important is this E of X is a family of vector spaces in this fixed function spaces. So now, so something like this. So this EI operations, I'm sorry, it's better to write it. This EI is a kind of map. EI gives a map E. I'm sorry, E gives a map. So this U1 to prime, U2 prime is something like this. So kind of L2 K U1 prime. No, L2 K KI prime X K1 prime cross L2 K K2 prime X cross maybe T0 infinity two maybe I don't know, a Grassmannian two. maybe better to say that I want to fix this E1, EN, this is the basis. So this basis of this EI gives a map from here to this fixed function spaces. So the claim is that you can choose a basis. Yes, so this is a map between two fixed Banach spaces. And the claim is that this is smooth in this first two coordinate. And in the last coordinate, this is exponential decay. This means that dEi dt, then this CL norm is smaller than this CL, it's CLK, it's the power CLK. T like this. So this means that for k is 1. This means that this gets almost constant in an exponential order when k goes to infinity, and it's smooth in any other parameters. And this looks rather cumbersome, but if you try to prove that this Green map and Green map behave nicely in a smooth way, then you will find that this exponential decay condition is something you need to prove it. On the other hand, so once we assume these conditions, then you can construct gluings in the same way as a kind of, you can just do the gluings in a balanced way we have written to prove that then the local Kuranishi chart is actually well defined and coordinate change is smooth. So this is a condition, kind of most kind of serious condition to check. So somehow what we need is just to find some way that this obstruction boundary is defined, and when this t goes to infinity, this obstruction boundary became more and more constant in exponential order. So if you describe that kind of way of this obstruction boundary, then this construction of Kuranishi structure afterward is in a black box. So that's a statement of this talk. Okay, thank you very much.